like to have some of your feedback, some discussion, and also, you know, just some help. There are always things that, you know, I need some help with or things like that. So if you could just be there for your input and just discussion on the different things that we can be doing, that'd be great. So just stop on by. It'll be right after service on the 22nd. And then it's not actually in the bulletin, but it has been past snow camp. We're actually going to be having our sign-up starting. So downstairs in the vestry, we'll have a sign-up sheet. Appreciate a $50 hold my spot at the time of sign-up, but if you don't have it, you can still sign up. It's $150 total for snow camp, but that should never be a hindrance. If you like to go, just talk with me, and I'll talk with Pastor John, and we'll make sure that if you know the need is there, we can find a way to make sure that you're able to come. So any questions, feel free to see me down the vestry after service. Thank you.
Yes, and our youth ministry is so important to us as a church, and parents, we need you. We can't do it without you. We can't lure the teens in. Snow camp is so much fun. Mount Monadnock, we're going to this year, right? Those events, it is really fun. It's there's good talks, but there's sledding and tubing and all kinds of fun games. It's a lot of fun. Right, Jen?
Yes.
So I see John, Jen's helping her coordinate that. Hope you go. All right, today is our beginning of our next junior disciples class. So let me tell you a little bit about that. So in January every year, for kids who are in second grade or older, we invite them to be in a class, which is with me, and it is getting their first Bible, and this is their Bible to keep. We've begun giving out nice leather-bound Bibles to our youngsters, and then they become theirs in confirmation. When they complete confirmation, we engrave their names on the front. They get a book plate when they complete the course with me. And there's a little booklet that they go through where they learn how to look up passages in the Bible. They have homework from the Old Testament where they'll read a psalm and the creation story and the Ten Commandments. And also from the New Testament where they'll read about Jesus' birth and death and resurrection and about his the great command to love. So they get their first Bible, and then their first Bible study with me on the last week is communion. Now today happens to be a communion Sunday. It's not usually communion Sunday when we give out the Bibles, but they'll learn what communion means, and then on our next communion Sunday in February, we'll celebrate their accomplishment. We'll give back to them. Their Bibles will be theirs to keep, and they'll sit up front and celebrate communion with us in a very special way. So do I have kids today? Those who are here know who you are. There's a couple I know who I don't see here this morning who are going to be in it. Maybe the snow and snow plowing. But if you're planning to be in our junior disciples class today, come on forward. Come on up front, Nick and Miranda. I knew it was going to be a small class this year. This will be great. More attention. More snacks. Except we don't have snacks today, but so Nicholas and Miranda, welcome to Junior Disciples. Here is your Bible, and here's your Bible. Okay, and we'll go through the class together. I'll give you your workbook in the class, and then we will celebrate when you guys are done. Okay, and there's a couple other kids I know that are going to be in our class too. Let's pray for Nicholas and Miranda. Dear God, thank you for the gift of your word, and thank you for these young people in our midst. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless our new junior disciples class, and today especially Miranda and Nicholas, as we gather together, as we learn from your word. Bless them as they grow. We pray all of this in Christ's name. Amen. How about a hand for our junior disciples? You guys can be seated. So parents and grandparents, or those who are caregivers, we will meet today. Where's Joanne Peterson? That upstairs corner, is that still the third grade room, second and third grade room? So we'll meet in the second and third grade room at 11. 7:30, we'll be done, especially with just two kids, we'll be done easily before 12. And we'll do that for the next couple of weeks. Anything else for announcers this morning that I forgot? Kids? Oh, Jen? I thought you taught middle school.
I don't. I teach third grade.
Oh, so yes, not a family Sunday. Let's see. Hold on.
I said we combine all the classes.
So, Jen.
Sorry.
Jesus is baptized. You got this.
I do.
You got it. So, would all the kids follow Mrs. Robbins out to Sunday school? I'm sorry about that. I thought you were teaching middle school. There's no middle school today. Love you. Hey there. Shoot, and I was going to make this a mistake-free year. Maybe I'll just continue to live by God's grace. How about that? You too? It's now a time to turn our attention to our God in prayer, being Communion Sunday. And by the way, very thrilled today. We are doing communion kind of old school for us. We've been doing it lately by intinction, where you come forward, which I like. And some of it's a time saver, because we don't like to keep you here forever. And you let us know when we keep you here too long. But we're doing the trays, and the trays were given in memory of John Commenda, who's Allison Commenda's husband, who passed away in the winter, so many years ago. But we're thrilled to do that today. So on Communion Sundays, we don't have sharing of joys and concerns, but I encourage you to take advantage of the prayer chain, prayer@fccholden.org, which is on the front. You can also call Allison if you're not an email person. And please note, I've started with the new year putting the summary on the back again in the prayer box. You can also turn there to jot things down. The one name that I would like to add to the names that are already listed is Andy Murray, who sadly took his life this past week. Nobody you know, but an acquaintance with my family. Please pray for his family as they grieve his loss. There are other joys and concerns you have. We will bring them before the Lord in a time of silent prayer. Let us pray. Dear God in heaven, how amazing it is to be able to come so freely into your presence. Thank you for this snowy weekend. Thank you for the reminder that we are washed and cleansed by you, and we are made whiter than snow. As the snow blankets the ground temporarily anyways and covers up the mess and the dirt, so Lord, you have covered up and cleaned up, but not temporarily, permanently, the messiness of our lives and our souls. Thank you, Lord, for washing us and cleansing us and making us whiter than snow. Thank you for the relationship that we have with you. And we come into your presence this morning in your name. Hear our prayers. Lord, we bring before you these who are listed. We pray for Skeels and the surgery that's coming up from this week, and watch over him. We pray for Ryan as he's trying to find his way. Watch over him and keep him safe and help him to get the help he needs. We pray for Carlene and for so many others who are battling with cancer. And we ask, Lord, that you would continue to open up new ways of research and help us to find a cure for cancer. Thank you for all the progress that's been made. And Lord, we pray for the Murray family and for their grief over the loss of Andy. And we ask, Lord, that you would give them comfort. Lord, thank you that in all these things you are present. Thank you that as our bodies have problems and give way in certain areas that you are there to help us and sustain us and heal us. And Lord, thank you that you're there when we feel lost and alone to lift us up and to help us find the way. And Lord, thank you that even in death and even in tragic death, you've given us victory in Christ and a hope that we can cling to. Lord, you are good, and we bring our prayers to you, and we ask that you would continue to be with us and to be with those we love and care about. Hear now, Lord, these whom we whisper before you in this time of silent prayer. Lord, these who've been spoken audibly, these who've been whispered in the silence and in the silence of our hearts, we lift before you. Lord, meet them in their need. Sometimes we think we know what we need, but you, Lord, ultimately know what we really need. So, Lord, may each one of these people, and ourselves as well, be enveloped in your love and your care. And may you, through your gracious, benevolent presence, pour out whatever is needed. Whatever is needed most, we'll trust you. Hear our prayers, O Lord. And Lord, we pray not only for ourselves individually and our friends and families, but for ourselves collectively. Be with us this year, and may we as a people grow spiritually and mature, both individually and collectively. Bless our junior disciples class and the young people in our midst. We pray for our friends next door at First Baptist Church, for Jeremy Stefano, their bridge pastor. Thank you that they've called a new pastor, Lord, and we await his coming this summer and pray that our unity and friendship with the Baptists would continue to be strong. In our community, we pray for winter safety, Lord. Please watch over all who are driving, and we mourn and grieve over the fatalities that seem to happen every time we have a storm. Watch over those who are walking and also those who play winter sports, Lord. And Lord, be with those who find this time after Christmas kind of sad and depressing, who have seasonal affective disorder. I pray that you would be with them. Lord, you are our hope, you are our joy, not the seasons, not excitement or lack thereof it, but you, Lord, are our joy. So lift them up and lift us up too. And Lord, we pray for our new Congress as it takes session. Be with our nation, Lord, as we seem to be very much in turmoil and more unsettled than usual. And so, Lord, be with our Congress. Thank you for our democracy. Thank you for how strong it's been and what an example to the world it's been. And continue to help us to work out our differences and to help our country to be strong. Lord, forgive us where we've become arrogant and where we've drifted from you. May we humble ourselves as our forefathers did so long ago and ask you to bring peace to our nation. We pray for the nations around the world and especially the Middle East. We think of Syria and all the ISIS threat in Iraq and all the unsettlement over there. Lord, be with those people. And thank you for the peace that we have here. We pray they would have the same. And finally, Lord, for the poor and the forgotten everywhere around the globe. Thank you that no one is forgotten by you, that you know every soul, you know every person, and you love them all, and you sent your Son to redeem every last one. Lord, may your gospel go out. May the good news of your love and your forgiveness in Christ be found in every nook and cranny of this globe. May salvation and new life be found, and may it spring up everywhere. Until that day you come again, till every knee bows and every tongue confess that you are Lord, we will continue to proclaim you. We will continue to worship you. We will continue to pray in Jesus' name as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Our first reading this morning is taken from the first book of John, verses 19 through 34, and may be found on page 1647 in your pew Bibles if you'd like to follow along. Now this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way for the Lord." Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany, on the other side of Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony, "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him, and I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and testify that this is God's chosen one.'" Here ends the first reading.
Our second reading today comes from 1 Peter, as we continue our journey through 1 Peter, chapter 3, verse 15 to the end of the chapter, which is verse 22. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. "But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from your body, but the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him." Here ends our second reading.
And our third reading is taken from the book of Matthew, chapter 28. Verses 16 through 20, and may be found on page 1553 in the Pew Bible. This is entitled The Great Commission. "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Here ends the third reading.
So I love verses like the one that Larry just read, the Great Commission. As a Christian, I don't know about you, but I like to be reminded what it is we're all about. Why do we do what we do? Why do we call ourselves Christians? What are we supposed to be all about? And I love the Great Command, which is to love God and to love others. And I love the Great Commission, which actually is our mission. It's to go into all the world, to proclaim Christ, to welcome people into relationship with Christ, into the church, through baptism, and to teach them to be disciples. To proclaim, to baptize, to make disciples. And it's in that framework that I want us to look at our very odd passage from 1 Peter today. This is one of those weird passages. It just says some stuff. There's some passages in the Bible that leave scholars for centuries scratching their head going, I wonder what exactly that means. But when we put it in the framework of that big picture, to proclaim, to baptize, and to make disciples, I think it makes a little more sense. This is the beginning of, well, we're sort of finishing up Christmas and getting into sort of the time of the year, the green colored time of the year, where we talk about Jesus' ministry. And you'll notice today in Sunday school, the kids are learning about Jesus being baptized, which we'll get to in a minute. But Jesus begins his ministry with baptism, and he immediately begins to proclaim that the kingdom of God is near. He was a man with a message. And it wasn't simply a message to be a good person. It was a message that God is coming near. And that God is going to come back and be with you. And he gave that message to the disciples. And the disciples went out kind of on training missions with Jesus. And they began to learn how to proclaim. And then when the Holy Spirit filled them, they proclaimed with power. And they went everywhere. And they said, Jesus is the Lord. And his death on the cross was for your sins. And God is calling the whole world to repent and to believe in him. And even today, God has called us to continue to proclaim that message. The Great Commission begins with, therefore, go. Now, our verse from Peter this morning brings up kind of an interesting thing. Where did Jesus go? Well, he went to the earth and he proclaimed over in the Middle East in Israel during his time here on earth. And then he died. And then what happened? This is such a curious verse. Look what Peter says. After being made alive, he went and made, being raised from the dead then, he went and made proclamation to imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. Some of you know, and this is one of these things, it's kind of a mystery. When Jesus died on the cross on Friday, and then he rose from the dead on Sunday, where did he go during those, on Saturday, where did he go? Well, this is where a lot of people would say Jesus went to hell, to proclaim the good news to those who had been disobedient long ago. Now, that's not a sure thing, but it's a verse like this that brings into that. That Jesus had gone and proclaimed the gospel to those who before Christ came and died were disobedient and gave them the opportunity to hear and to believe. He went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago. Remember the story of Noah? So God is very upset with the world because of the way they live. And by the way, we live under this incredible umbrella of God's grace. God is still upset with the world. God's kind and he's gentle. He's not happy with how we live and how we treat one another. If you really look at it, go home and watch the news if you've forgotten. We're not happy either. And so God finally said in the days of Noah, I've had enough, I'm going to destroy the earth. But he said, but I'm going to start over with Noah. 8 people were on that boat. He saved them, destroyed everybody else, and started over again. Okay, let me go back here. I got ahead of myself. So in the days of Noah, he saved them. Now we're going to get the baptism in a second. I apologize. Backing up just a little bit. So Jesus went and proclaimed the gospel to those imprisoned spirits long ago and gave them a chance. We also are called to proclaim the gospel. This is where this fits in. This is my favorite verse. So if you don't remember anything else I said today, remember this. I love this. In your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. The older NIV says, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. My friends, as we're called to go out, as the apostles went out, as Jesus went out, as Jesus maybe even went to dark spiritual places from long ago, however that works, he's called us to go out. Not many of us are going to be street corner evangelists. In fact, I'm not even really sure that's the best method. But if you can set apart Christ as Lord in your heart and be ready to share your faith. One of our confirmation kids this morning was telling us that they read the Christmas story to a friend of theirs who didn't believe. Because I said, read the Christmas story. And I said, well, how did that go? Well, I don't know, but they listened. But be ready to share your faith in these kind of gentle and respectful ways. This is our part, and I think this is the part for most of us. The term is relational evangelism. A lot of churches talk about this, people preach about this, that the best way to win people to Christ is simply through the relationships you have. And in those relationships, not being ashamed of your faith, but being willing to talk about it. And please don't listen to the lie that is sometimes propagated. Well, I don't want to always be talking about my faith. I want to live it. That's true. You need to do that. But hear this. No one is saved by you giving them a loaf of bread. Nobody is saved by you mowing their lawn or giving them a check. No one is saved by you doing a kind deed for them. But if they hear of Christ and they believe in Christ in their heart and confess Him as Lord and Savior, then their sins are washed and cleansed whiter than snow. They're reunited with God and there's salvation. You see, the best gift you can give to people you love is to tell them how much God loves them. To tell them what Christ did for them. You can't force them to believe, but to give them the opportunity to believe and to be saved and to be reconciled with God. Secondary to that, of course, mow their lawn, give them money, give them bread, take care of them, absolutely. We are called to join with Jesus and the apostles and the saints of every age in proclaiming the message of Christ. It's not a low priority. It's not do all that's good to the world and oh yeah, also tell about Christ. It's proclaim Christ and while you're doing it, care about everything else. Let's let that matriculate back to the top. It doesn't have to be loud. It doesn't have to be obnoxious. In fact, it's probably more of a turn off than a turn on. But with gentleness and respect, set Christ apart as Lord and always be ready and willing to share your faith. So we proclaim and we baptize. This is where I got a little off on my track here. So on that day of Pentecost, and we're talking about a confirmation this morning, Peter, in this great tradition, filled with the Holy Spirit, got up and he didn't feed the multitude. He didn't serve communion. He didn't sing a song. He proclaimed the gospel. And people were cut to the heart. And they said to Peter and the apostles, what should we do? And he said, repent, turn away from your way and whatever it is, turn to God and be baptized, every one of you. As Jesus began his ministry, he was baptized. John, as Larry read for us, called people to repent of their sins and to be baptized for the forgiveness of sins. Jesus was baptized by John. Interestingly, Jesus never water baptized anybody. But John himself said, Jesus brings a different baptism. He's not going to baptize you with water, but he's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit. To be baptized means to be immersed in. When you're baptized, there's a verse in the Old Testament that says the Israelites were baptized into Moses. They were immersed into the care of Moses. When you're baptized, you're immersed in water. When you're baptized with the Holy Spirit, you're immersed in the presence of God and the Holy Spirit. It is, I want to say, the greater baptism, but it is the baptism that it's all about. So Jesus was baptized, and the church has always baptized people. It is the initiatory ritual into the church. Somehow that has kind of become a little lesser thing. My friends, every Christian should be baptized. In the early days, it was more adults and believers. You'd hear the gospel, you'd say, I believe that, and you'd be baptized. Philip, one of the apostles, was called to an Ethiopian eunuch early on in the book of Acts, and he heard the scriptures explained, said, oh my gosh, I believe in Jesus, I should be baptized. And they stopped the chariot, and they found some water, and he went immediately, and he was baptized. It's so important to be baptized. Peter draws this analogy again in kind of this quirky verse. He talks about Noah and his ark. And he talks about how 8 people were saved through the water in the boat. And he says it symbolizes baptism. It is kind of a weird construct. And don't read too much into this because I think it just leads us down crazy paths. But in the ark, only a few people, 8 in all, were saved through water. This water symbolizes the baptism that now saves you. Now, I often think of Noah's ark that way too. It's like God is place judgment on the world, he's going to destroy it, but he's going to save a remnant. My friends, it's still the same in Christ. Again, don't be overcome. You live in such grace and goodness, but God's wrath and judgment is still there. But he doesn't want to bring it out on the earth. And he's created a new ark. It's in Christ. And those who enter into Christ will be saved from all the judgment and all the destruction that God will eventually bring on the earth. Noah and his family saved. Baptism now symbolizes that salvation. Notice it's a symbol. It's not salvation. Notice if that's not clear to you, the next part of the verse, the baptism now says you're not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. So you're saying it's not an external ritual. It's not taking a bath that cleanses you. And please don't read anything else. It's not some sacred holy water that's been blessed and now has magical properties, that if it touches you when it's been blessed by the pastor or the priest, has some magical properties to save you. No, it's a symbol. It's a symbol of being washed. It's a symbol of being cleansed. It's a symbol of you repenting and pledging a clear conscience towards God. We proclaim, when we hear that proclamation, we welcome people to enter in to relationship with Christ, to enter into the church. The gatekeeping ritual has always been baptism. Baptism doesn't save you. No ritual has ever saved any human being except for Christ on the cross. Your faith in Christ saves you. And then finally, and this I just added on, we make disciples. We proclaim the word. We welcome people into relationship with Christ. And then we make disciples. It's not enough simply to hear the word of God, to say, yes, I believe, to be baptized, to make that proclamation, and then go back out and live like hell again. We need to be continually growing. And I just put 1 Peter up there as an example. That's why we continue to read God's word. That's why you continue to come to church and hear God's word taught and explained, and why you read Christian books and read your Bible, and why daily you repent of your sins and say, God, I blew it again, but forgive me. I want to be the person that you've called me to be. I want to be the person you've called me to be in Scripture, and we continue to grow. This is our mission, friends. This is the great commission, is to go into all the earth, to make disciples of all nations, to teach them to obey everything that God has commanded, to proclaim, to baptize, to make disciples. This is our mission. As we come before the table today, I think this is interesting, and it's been in my mind all week. When we send out from our church to care for people, what do? Well, we bring them a flower. I'm not trying to minimize this stuff. I'm just trying to maximize my point. We bring them a flower. Sometimes we bring them communion. We might bring them a prayer. But when the early disciples went out, all of that was secondary. They brought them the word of God. Ever hear people say to you, what's the good word? Tell them. They don't need food, they don't need a ritual, but they need to hear the word of God. Gently, respectfully. Your family, your friends, your neighbors, your loved ones, the world. This table seems to be not the thing that was spread out for the whole world, but a thing that the believers did when they gathered together. And the table was to remind the believers of what was most central to that message. That Jesus Christ died on the cross. That because of that, our sins are forgiven. Because of that, we're cleansed. And so God can come near and enter and live in us through the Holy Spirit. We celebrate communion, and the church has always done this, so we would never forget the centrality of Christ's sacrifice for us. And so with that in mind, you're invited to come for the table today.
Thank you.
Today you are invited to come to this table. This table prepared for you in the name of our Lord. If you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you're welcome at this table. It doesn't matter how the road has been that got you here today. If you hear his voice and you desire to commune with him, you're welcome at this table. Sinners are welcome here. In fact, sinners are required here to remember and express their faith and to find strength to be the people that God has called them to be. And so, Lord, bless this bread and this cup as symbols of our faith and belief in you. And as we partake it together, strengthen our faith. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Again, today you'll remain seated, and our deacons, ushers, elders will bring the trays to you. And one of the beauties of this is that we'll hold it and we'll all eat and drink together as one body. The bread will come first. And so remember that on the night our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. And as often as you eat it, do this in remembrance of me." So ministering to you in his blessed and holy name, we share with you this bread. Remembering our Lord Jesus Christ, from indeed whom all blessings flow, let us eat this bread together. In a similar way, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. And as often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." So now, ministering to you in his blessed and holy name, we share with you this cup. Remembering our Lord Jesus Christ, let's drink this cup together. Now would you please turn in your bulletins and join with me in the prayer of thanksgiving. Let us pray. Almighty God, we believe in your grand act of love, which brings us salvation, and we have declared our faith at this table. We believe that Jesus died on the cross for our sins and that we are forgiven. We believe that Jesus rose from the dead and that we have new life. Thank you for these gracious gifts. Fill us anew with your Holy Spirit, giving us the power to do what is right and to be devoted followers of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord has given to us freely. Now you are invited to freely give. No obligation, but simply from the heart. Our morning offering will now be received. Let us pray. Dear God, we are so thankful for the gifts that you've given to us. Thank you for the proclamation of your word that has told us of your birth, of your death, of your resurrection, of our salvation. Lord, what wonderful gifts have been proclaimed to us and received. Receive now these, our humble offerings that we give to you in return. And Lord, use them to strengthen the ministry of your church in this place, to help those in need and to spread the gospel across the street and to the ends of the earth, until that day you come again in all your glory. Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please.
for us to gather today, to seek God in worship, in prayer, to hear from His Word, to offer ourselves to Him as He's offered ourselves, His self, to us. Now go and do what the Lord has placed on your heart. Go and repent of your sins. Go and be the people that He's called you to be. And in big ways and in little ways, with gentleness and respect, share the hope that is in you. Proclaim Christ in all you do. Go in peace. Go with God's blessing. Go filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and serve the Lord with joy. Amen.
They say the confession is good for the soul. I forgot to tell Peter what the benediction response is. So we're going to sing Go in Peace.